Welcome to Växjö, the greenest city in Europe, home of the hockey team Växjö Lakers. In this movie, we're going to visit some of the most popular tourist attractions in the city. Over to our reporter, Joe.
So today I'm here with a famous professor of history in Växjö. Wilhelm Wren, what do you have to say about this big church?
Yes, this magnificent church. It was built during the Middle Ages of the Swedish century. It burnt down many times actually, but since the 18th and 19th and 20th century, it was actually restored to its original glory. During the 17th century, it was a very big part of the Swedish Växjö city. The town is actually built around this.
That sounds very interesting. So let's head inside. And here we are at the Tree of Light. It is one of the many beautiful art pieces in this church. And now we are here at the altar. As a matter of fact, the glass skull has actually been taken once before, but it's now replaced with another new skull.
Yes, but there are actually 12 skulls here representing the...
And here we are in the oldest room of the church. These paintings could actually be traced all the way back into the 14th century. But now, something completely else. Over to you, Anton.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to our magnificent ruin, our castle, Kronoberg Castle, in the middle of this lake. This castle was originally built. The basic constructions began in the middle of the 15th century, when the bishops of Växjö sought refuge in times of trouble. In 1527, when a king, glorious Swedish king Gustav Vasa, sought to bring in the Protestantism into Sweden, take the lands from the church and give it to the state, he took all this entire castle and its riches to the state. The bishops no longer had possession of this castle. And these reforms made peasants very angry throughout the entire county of Småland. And so the Dacke Rebellion, or Dacke Upproret, as whatever you like to call it, made this castle taken over by the peasants, or the rebels, as they were by the time. And later, they held this castle for 2 years approximately before they were ultimately struck down by the Swedish forces, the king's forces. But they used this as a base of operations to launch their guerrilla attacks against the king's men. After this rebellion, the king realized the importance of having a strategic and powerful castle in this area to protect it against the peasants, who would still be very mad at them, at him, and to protect against the angry Danes, who would also seek to capture this area. The Danes and the Swedes, they have always been very mad at each other. And it was even so that in 1612, the year 1612, the Danes even attacked this castle once. And it was the last time this castle saw battle. In 1612, Danes attacked, they rolled in here, but they were struck down by well-armed, well-prepared forces. And that was the final time the castle was ever used militarily in the defense of the Danes. Later, it was decaying, and by the end of the 17th century, it was ultimately a ruin. Here we are at the wonderful Iverdal. Now on to our reporter, Joe.
So, Andre, you're one of the more common visitors around here. Why do you like this place so much?
Mostly because of the jumping tower.
Okay. So, do the Swedes often go for a swim?
Yeah, but it's quite cold. But in the midsummer, it feels great.
So, how are people like on the beach in Sweden?
Yeah, they're quite calm and quiet.